Hi viewers, in this video I will show you how I removed, tested and installed a steering wheel Clockspring on a 2010 Jeep Patriot.
To begin, the vehicle was parked on a level floor with the steering wheel centered and the front wheels in a straight ahead position. Once in place, I double-checked the OBD2 codes with my scan tool. Here you can see the B1B02 and the B1B06 codes. Usually, a driver airbag squib open circuit problem is caused by a defective ribbon cable or a bad contact inside the Clockspring assembly. To remove and replace the Clockspring, first the airbag had to be removed. As required, I disconnected the battery negative cable and I waited at least 2 minutes to discharge the airbag capacitor. Then I undid the two bolts holding the driver airbag. The airbag must be carefully pulled out and handled to be able to safely unplug the two squib connectors. Note, sometimes the connectors can be hard to unplug. After, I placed the non-deployed airbag far from the working area on a soft surface with the face in an upward position. I also disconnected the horn switch connector before pulling out the steering wheel. I used a 13mm socket to undo the steering wheel retaining bolt. Here you can see the key splines that are used to align the steering wheel with the steering shaft. I had to firmly pull out and wiggle the steering wheel by hand to remove it. Note, I was careful to avoid damaging the two squib connectors. To gain access to the Clockspring assembly, the steering column shrouds had to be disassembled. I used a T15 Torx bit to undo the lower screw and a Phillips head screwdriver to undo the other ones. The lower shroud is normally removed, but personally, I simply lowered it as shown. It is useful to check the routing of the electrical harness branches before removing the spring clock assembly. On a new clock spring, a locking pin called grenade pin is normally used to keep the rotor centered at the 0° position. I didn't have this item, so I used two small cable ties to keep the Clockspring rotor centered during the handling. The T15 bit was also required to undo the three screws holding the steering column control module assembly. This Clockspring bracket is built with two side guides, so it must be lifted a bit before pulling out the assembly. After, unplug the four connectors behind the control module assembly. Next, I place the assembly on the workbench and I remove the cable ties. Then, I disconnected the multifunction switches to inspect the Clockspring. To measure the electrical resistance between the contacts, it's good practice to use the ohm function of a digital multimeter. The first current resistance was 0.3 ohm. The second one was 0.4 ohm. The third one was 0.3 ohm. And the last one was around 12 ohms. The last result was far off from the other ones, so it confirmed that the ribbon circuit was damaged and the Clockspring had to be replaced. Not long after, at the automotive recycler facility, I found a used Clockspring, but I tested the resistance of the FFC ribbon conductors before buying the parts. Later in my garage, I repeated the procedure on the workbench to show you the results. And they were 0.3 ohm, 0.4 ohm, 0.3 ohm, and 0.3 ohm. A Clockspring rotor properly centered at 0 degree can be freely rotated, two full turns on each side without any ribbon restriction. If not, it has to be recentered by rotating the rotor clockwise until the end of the ribbon travel with a minimal tension. From there, the rotor was rotated in the counterclockwise direction about 2 turns and 3/4. Then the horn connector receptacle should be close to the 0 degree center. Once done, the rotor can be kept at the 0 degree position with a locking pin or 2 cable ties. Not long after, I reassembled the 2 multifunction switches on the spring clock housing. Before refitting the assembly on the steering shaft, I checked if all the connectors were well positioned. This electrical harness branch and this cable tie on the right side must not interfere with the front right bracket during the installation. First, I connected the C1, the C2 and the C4 connectors, then I partially fitted the assembly. And after, I connected the steering angle connector. I properly seated the retaining brackets and I fastened the 3 screws. Next, I removed the cable ties to refit the plastic shrouds. The steering wheel splines must be well aligned to fit with the steering shaft splines. At the same time, the rotor drive pin has to be aligned and inserted in the steering wheel drive pin location. A small effort and a bit of wiggling was enough to fit the parts together. When the steering wheel was in place, I connected the horn switch plug. For more safety, I added a drop of thread locker on the bolt. I fastened it and I set the torque to 37 foot-pounds. Note, the squib connectors are keyed to avoid connection mistakes. After, when they were properly connected, I inserted the airbag assembly in place. Then, to secure the assembly, I fastened the 2 retaining bolts. Soon after, I reconnected the battery and I tested the horn. Using my scan tool, I erased the stored codes and there was no more airbag warning light showing. I also performed a live data reading of the steering angle sensor and the result was matching the 0 degree position of the steering wheel.
There is always a risk of airbag deployment when removing, handling and installing an airbag. So I always follow the safety procedures required by the manufacturer.